331 BC. Alexander the Great is on the attack, taking on the massive Persian army of Darius, King of Kings. Can Darius hold on to his colossal empire, or will the hot-headed young Alexander seize it from him by force? Commanding one of the armies is a team of childhood friends. But will their 33-year friendship stand up in the heat of battle?
Send the cavalry from the hill.
I just said that, actually.
I just wasn't listening to you, Nigel.
These comrades in arms must not only carry the day, but impress two military experts.
I want to get stuck in.
This will be a bloody battle of epic proportions.
The team have got to hold them by the nose and kick them in the nuts.
This is Time Commanders. With Eddie Mayer in our 21st century war room are a team of childhood friends. Richard Marshall, freelance photographer, rank general. Richard Spencer, business strategy manager, rank general. John Fox, communications manager, rank lieutenant. Nigel Davis, eye surgeon, rank lieutenant.
Childhood friends, eh? John, former rat catcher and pest controller, you look a bit like the guy who cheated on Who Wants to Be a Millionaire.
Thank you so much for saying that. I do appreciate that.
That's why there's no prize money.
It has been noticed.
Now, you're all 30-somethings.
Here we are. Mm-hmm.
But you've been friends since you were how old?
Five.
What's kept you together all this time?
We know each other so well that there's sort of nothing we can say that'll insult them enough to make them go away. We'll just keep coming back to get our own back.
Believe me, we have tried.
All right. Nigel, you were captain of the fencing team at Oxford?
I was.
So you enjoy fighting in some civilized form?
Yes.
What about these sort of battles? You all as a group like to do this kind of thing, strategy games, don't you?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, particularly when we were in our teens, we played a lot of wargaming and Dungeons and Dragons and Risk and things like that. So we're kind of trying to recapture that youth today, hopefully.
So you are good at this kind of thing. Victory is imminent, is it?
Yes. Fortune favours the brave.
Let's find out more about the battle you're going to fight. Down here are our experts, Mark and Eric. Gentlemen, if you come up, they've been checking all the fine details of the battle you're going to fight, making sure that every aspect of it is as historically accurate as we can get away with.
Dr. Eric Nussbacher, senior lecturer in war studies, Royal Military Academy, Sandhurst. Mark Urban, military historian and author.
Right, you are being given the Battle of Gaugamela.
Oh, yes.
Now, Gaugamela is in modern-day Iraq by the Iranian border. You are Alexander the Great and his army, one of the greatest armies in all of military history. Your opponents are the Persians. You've already beaten them twice, and their empire is hanging there like a ripe peach. The name of the game is regime change. You've got to go in, take over their empire, and you won't be able to do that by just sitting down and reading the entrails of your sacrifices. They outnumber you, but remember, you're Macedonians.
Who said fortune favors the brave?
I did.
You guys are coming up against a vast army. They will massively outnumber you. And the only way that you're going to survive to create your own empire out in the east is by taking the initiative.
Before battle commences, the team must gather military intelligence. First up is a survey of the terrain. The battlefield is a broad, flat plain with a river on one side and some rocky hills on the other. But neither will offer any flank protection to the team's small Macedonian army. It is early morning on the 1st of October, 331 BC. Waiting across the other side of this dusty, featureless plain is the massive Persian army of Darius, King of Kings.
It's fairly flat. Mm-hmm. I don't know if that's must be a slope down to the river there, and then another hill.
A slope up to the hill here.
I think the question for us is the degree to which we want to get drawn into this.
Yeah.
Well, you definitely don't want to go into the middle bit there. If you could use the steep hills to stop them coming around, that would any troops going to go up a hill and going to come down, that's going to take a little bit of time, isn't it? So that could be a natural sort of barrier to them going that way.
Whereas if we have our troops, especially the cavalry, somewhere, I don't know, they can come down.
No? Yeah. Well, the only thing is, if we spend too long just sort of waiting, trying to be too clever, I wonder whether we're just going to get ourselves boxed in.
Richard Spencer has correctly identified that the need for aggression is far more important than the geographical features of the battlefield, which offer little tactical advantage to their troops. But will the team take Richard's advice? Before making a final decision, the team must first recce their own army. Lieutenants John and Nigel can now inspect Alexander the Great's Macedonian army to find out about the troops they will control in battle. It is vital that the generals understand which lieutenant controls which troops. The team's 47,000-strong army is outnumbered more than 3-1 by the Persians. The key Macedonian attack troops are the Companion Cavalry, the noblemen closest to Alexander the Great, both at court and in war. The core of their army is the tough, heavy infantry, the pike phalanx. The team must coordinate these troops to outwit the vast army they face.
Can we go through sort of fairly methodically what each of the bunches are? Just start
okay,
out.
So these guys here are the group generals.
General at the front. Then
what's
after
that next
them,
line? You've got the
pikemen.
Pikemen, OK. We've got four of them.
The Macedonian pikemen are armed with an 18-foot pike. These disciplined, professional soldiers fight shoulder to shoulder, their pikes thrust forward in a formation known as the phalanx. The hedgehog-like phalanx advances slowly and is almost unstoppable as long as it can hold formation.
Look at all those points. In order to get to the men in this phalanx, you've got to get past one row, two rows, three rows, four rows, five, row upon row of points out in front of these soldiers. They're very well protected as long as they stick together.
Then you've got heavy cavalry. These guys are going to be great for punching a hole maybe through infantry.
Alexander's army does what the Soviet army used to call sword and shield. The shield, the infantry, fix the enemy in place. And then the sword, the cavalry, strike the enemy.
In previous encounters with the Persians, Alexander the Great used his pike phalanx to fix the Persian front line. His companion cavalry would then seek out weak points in the enemy ranks and attack with devastating effect.
Alexander's tactics can be summarized in George Patton's phrase, hold him by the nose and kick him in the nuts.
After the heavy cavalry, you've got three more pike units, okay? Then the archers, and then after them, you've got one block of light cavalry.
And then,
and then these guys are the javelin throwers. They've got a poorer range than the archers.
The javelin men are lightly armored infantry from remote parts of Macedonian territory. Armed with bundles of short throwing javelins, they avoid close combat, but can inflict serious damage with their missiles. Fast and agile, they can move wherever needed on the battlefield to harass enemy lines.
Nige?
Yeah.
Tell us what you got.
Right, you've got a big unit of cavalry and then two units of Greek hoplites. They will attack with spears and they're quite quick.
The hoplites are Alexander's Greek allies. Armed with a thrusting spear, short sword, and large shield, they also fight in a phalanx formation. But with shorter spears, the hoplites are less formidable than the pikemen. These troops would be best used as reserves behind the wall of steel of the pike phalanx.
And then behind that, you've got two units of infantry, and in the middle of those is the general with his small unit of heavily armed cavalry.
Alexander's most potent weapon on the battlefield was his cavalry. Alexander was a very aggressive commander, and he led his cavalry in person.
Leading from the front was a risky tactic. At the Battle of the River Granicus 3 years earlier, Alexander barely escaped with his life. But the sight of the great general charging into battle paid dividends, inspiring his own troops and terrifying the Persians.
The Battle of Gaugamela, you are Alexander the Great, up against Darius, 331 BC, and you still need to know something, don't you? More than you do?
We need to know about our enemy.
Of course.
Very much.
Let's do that right now.
The team have methodically gathered all the information they need about their own army. But will they be as sharp in assessing their enemy? Eye surgeon Nigel orders his scouts across the plain to spy on the Persians.
There's a lot of them. I think you were warned you'd be outnumbered, but did you expect it would be this bad?
Wow. What have we got? Really long, thin lines.
What you've got here is light cavalry and heavy cavalry. Heavy cavalry in the middle and light cavalry at the front and the back. Then four lines of troops, and they are Persian singers. Slingers.
Slingers?
They don't sing, they sling.
The Persian army, the great mass of these people, great numbers of them, 40 to 50,000 in each case, are either archers or slingmen, missile troops, trying in some way to get a kill with an arrow or with a stone. It's a much more basic form of warfare, and it's much harder, I think, for them to use that force to stop the phalanx.
Then you've got the javelin behind, and then the third row are the archers, and then you've got the spears, the fourth row of the spears. We want to move the scouts across the centre now. Going to take a risky move and just
ride along the face of the enemy. What, yeah. In front of the slingshots?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's going to work.
OK, so right in the middle, at the back, you've got Greek mercenaries. And the far right, you've got three more groups of cavalry. The Persians are using their cavalry to protect their flanks.
Contact with the Macedonians has forced the Persians to update their cavalry. They've got rid of the old javelins that they used to throw. They've given them a longer sword, a bigger shield. The Persian cavalry that we see on the field today are capable of mixing in with the Macedonian cavalry on nearly equal terms. But one thing that you cannot do, if you try to drive these horses at pikes or at a crowd of men holding pikes, the horses, who are quite clever, are going to move away. You're not going to be able to use these Persian cavalry against a phalanx.
So it's slings, javelins, archers, spears, but in the middle at the back you've got Greek mercenaries and the general. Okay, so we'll back off, because I think we've found out all we need to.
Do you want to quickly whiz back into those fields where the by the river? I just want to double check there's nothing hidden behind the cavalry there. Anyone see anything?
Can't see anything.
The team have been thorough. They've spotted all of the enemy units and combed the battlefield for any surprises. But will the two Richards keep their eye on the big picture? The generals must remember just how wide that Persian front line is as they start to formulate their battle plan.
Let's just kind of step back a bit. Being aggressive early on.
Yes.
Okay. So we mustn't be too defensive.
If you use all the pikemen together, you've only got two sides where they're weak. If you separate them all, you've got lots of two sides.
Yes.
So they're weak everywhere.
Okay.
So they're probably better off just being used as a block together, or maybe in two blocks, rather than being separated.
Basically, Alexander's won his battles in the past by leading his... He's led his cavalry to the weak points of the enemy.
And the weak point is...
John has got the right idea. John is saying that Alexander himself must lead that charge in.
The second decision is, which part of the Persians are we going to attack and with what?
And that's where
we're not going to use the cavalry head-on against the infantry, because that's where they're weak. So we could use a wedge formation of the cavalry and attack the junction between the cavalry and the troops with a wedge attack.
Mm. Nigel has spotted a very important tactical Macedonian reality, which is the best point to put the point of your wedge is at a gap in the enemy formations. A natural physical effect of forcing your way into the gap and causing the enemy who see those horsemen coming to scatter and break up the formation.
If you do attack with cavalry, you have to follow it up with something afterwards immediately, because there's no point in just sort of killing a few, whatever. You've got to really go for it in one big whoosh.
I think Nigel's made a very good point there, which is that the cavalry, unsupported on any battlefield throughout centuries, millennia even, of military history, will not achieve much.
That's right.
You have to be hot on their heels with the heavy infantry to capitalise on any success.
Right. One of the plan is cavalry and these infantrymen come up trying to separate the cavalry and the infantry from the front there, yeah?
Yeah, to punch a way in. And then we want to send the main infantry, the shorter stuff,
all coming in round one flank.
We're nearly there. We've just got to work out what we do with these.
What we do with these people.
We need these guys out here. Yeah?
Yeah.
They need to form this kind of wall of steel.
So this is just a line of pipes advancing.
Yes.
Right.
There's a line of pipemen there, and everyone else is there attacking from the side.
Yeah. And we've got archers there, cavalry in reserve up here.
The team's plan is really impressive.
The only thing that I think, looking at it, that may be a drawback at this stage is they don't really have a second line, as Alexander did, a proper reserve element to meet emergencies on the flanks.
That's your plan, and it was good to hear.
Sort of.
Now it's time, gentlemen, to deploy your troops.
The year is 331 BC. A team of childhood friends control Alexander the Great's small but high-quality Macedonian army against the vast forces of the Persian Empire. The team's battle plan is aggressive. They want to start the attack with their companion cavalry on their right flank, while their pike phalanx pins the Persian front line. But will the team be able to put aside 33 years of beautiful friendship and become the brutally efficient military commanders necessary to win this bloody fight?
You've got a heavy cavalry at the front and light cavalry, I think, at the back.
Are any of these troops moving?
Can somebody pay the troops or whatever it is they need to get moving?
Maybe they need to be inspired by great generals.
Are the archers on your side, Nigel?
No, they're not. They're under Johnny's control.
I completely forgot about controlling different sides of the screen.
Yeah.
That's very important you two both understand now.
You should just direct Johnny and I'll direct Nigel.
OK.
Johnny, you've got to get your archers over to the left-hand side to follow the cavalry.
There we go. We have some movement.
Get the pikes at the back and start to move them in formation straight down the middle.
With their command structure finally sorted out, the generals start to deploy their cavalry, hoplites and pike phalanx.
If we look at the phalanx here, we can see how they deploy with rows upon rows of spear points. Now, clearly, whether you're a Persian levy guy with a slingshot or whether you're a cavalry horse, that's a frightening prospect. And in fact, one of the Roman generals who came up against the Macedonian phalanx said it was the most terrifying thing he'd ever seen in his life.
Nigel,
are we doing a wedge attack, aren't we, with Johnny as a...
Yes, you're going to be getting most of the cavalry on your side, and I think we might... Nigel, you've got some cavalry.
That group out there to the right, that's our heavy cavalry,
right,
forming a wedge formation.
These companion cavalry, they really are shock troops for the Macedonians, and when they go into battle, they literally go into battle wedged up, with their leader at the point of a triangle and the troops coming out behind him. It's a very difficult formation to adopt and to maintain, but it's a very powerful one in shock action charges, particularly into thin lines of enemy infantry.
Do you want the generals with the heavy cavalry?
I think so, yeah.
Yeah.
John has got the right idea. Alexander himself must lead that charge in because he rode at the point of this wedge-shaped formation. All the commander had to do was see the gap and ride towards the gap, and he knew that the rest of his squadron would go with him and exploit the gap.
Richards, yes. Richards, would you like a little extra help?
Yes.
Come back to the table. And we've already given you far more help and information than Alexander the Great ever had, but because we like you, look at this satellite view.
Whoa.
This new bird's eye view reveals the huge width of the enemy lines and the sheer scale of the task that faces the team.
Nige?
Yeah?
What's that big line of troops at the front moving forward? Is that your pikemen or what?
Yeah, that's my pikemen. The other three that are moving off to the right are the hoplites, which are very similar to the pike phalanx, but probably not quite as strong.
These are some of the hoplites, and the hoplites are using shorter spears than those pikes, which means that they're a little more agile, they can turn a bit more on the battlefield, but the price they pay is there are not as many lines of points out in front of that formation.
Johnny, what's going on? What are you...
Well, we've got the heavy cavalry down there in a wedge formation, followed up by the light cavalry and the generals behind.
OK. Have you dispatched those archers over to the left-hand side and got rid of them?
Yeah, the archers have gone over onto the left-hand side.
Having overcome their initial confusion, the team are starting to get it together. Their troops are moving into a well-ordered formation. Deployment is looking slick.
Nice looking line.
The team's deployment is really very impressive. The team has done a very good job of deploying their infantry in a way that will enable them to pursue their plan. Their concept looks like it'll work.
But suddenly the team aren't so sure. They're only now coming to terms with the enormity of the Persian army, and they're starting to doubt their battle plan.
We are spread out pretty thin now, aren't we?
We're spread out terrifyingly thin. I didn't realise how wide their
yes,
troops were.
Yes, it's very wide, isn't it? I mean, do we need to use some of these troops in the back to bolster up the line?
Yeah, we've got to have somebody to fill
that line.
We're
not going to win by holding too many guys in reserve, are we?
No, you're not going to win at all. You're going to get completely slaughtered.
The team have decided to put all their troops into their initial push, which means they won't have anything in reserve if their battle plan goes pear-shaped. They're taking a big risk.
Can you just explain why it's suddenly so daunting seeing the enemy?
There's a hell of a lot of them.
But they were there earlier.
Yeah. They just didn't look so big then.
I think we didn't realise that when we actually spread our pikemen out, they would actually look quite so feeble.
Yes.
Which they do. They just look really feeble.
Do you think you're doomed, or is this winnable?
I think we might have to rejig the plan a bit.
We might have to rethink the plan, yeah. So yeah. We've just realised just how terrifying the enemy is.
The Persian army is huge, but actually the great bulk of them are little more than a mob. They're levies, they're local peasants with bad teeth and rickets who've been thrown into the battle line, and really they're there to look good, to impress, but they have very little fighting capability.
So we've got cavalry,
yep,
going in a wedge.
Yep.
The javelins are the line behind them.
Yeah.
Okay. And they're going to back up the cavalry. So when the cavalry charge in, you've got the javelins to come.
Okay, but you need to get the other guys to move up with them to hem the.
Okay. So do we want them at the side? Do we want them kind of? Do we want to split up our line and have them in the middle? What? We don't want to split up the line, do we? Because we don't want to have a hole. That's going to be a weak point in our line of hoplites.
I kind of feel we ought to slightly push them out to the right.
Yeah.
But quite advanced.
The team plan to pin the Persians with their pikemen and attack with their companion cavalry. It's a very good battle plan, but it requires aggression, and they're still intimidated by the enemy. The two Richards need to stop dithering and start getting mean.
Should you change your plan just because you've been slightly intimidated by the enemy?
Only if we can see a better one.
They can talk about changing their plan all they like, but it looks like Darius is moving in on them. I don't think they've got time to change anything now.
They're moving, aren't they?
Yeah.
Okay, guys.
Okay. Get your troops moving. Get your troops moving.
Yeah, okay. When are we going to start our cavalry assault? Okay. Because they are coming towards us.
Right.
Yeah, that's fine. There's yeah, but the narrower the terrain, the better movement. It is for us.
I thought this was an aggressive tactic. Where's the aggression?
It'll come.
You're right. Going to decide, you two, aren't you, yeah? When it's time to go.
What advice have you got, Nigel? It's all very well to give us the old maniacal laughter, but
yeah.
What do you think we should be doing?
Well, I think we should be attacking them, and I think we should be...
Nigel says you should be sticking it to him.
Oh, I like Nigel. Get stuck in.
OK, let's attack on this flank.
Yeah.
Johnny, start your attack with the cavalry wedge. Into the infantry?
Yeah, into the infantry.
They've got an exposed flank.
But at the same time, move forward your troops so that they're still sort of... They've got the cavalry
the infantry up to back them up.
Despite their uncertainty, the team have started their assault on the right. Alexander and his companion cavalry go charging in.
Once the team start executing this plan, they must not stop. If they stop, they'll be shot to pieces by Persian archers wherever they happen to be.
We're going to be slaughtered. If we send our cavalry into their infantry with their cavalry on the flank.
We've done it.
Suck it and see. Now, it's important that the team's cavalry don't get bogged down in close combat, that they hit and then go and look for another gap to hit into.
Send the infantry to back up the cavalry. Come on, bring it all forwards now.
John's cavalry have smashed into the Persian infantry's flank, inflicting heavy casualties. As a mass of Persian cavalry charge into them from the right, the team's light infantry make a timely appearance. The outcome of this first big engagement hangs in the balance. The childhood friends are in danger of losing both their elite troops and their general. Over on the left flank, the eye surgeon needs to put on his glasses. A unit of Nigel's cavalry, unable to move without orders, is being picked off by Persian archers.
Who's this guy here?
That's the reserve.
Come on, let's get them in.
We're going to send the cavalry in. I'm going to send the cavalry right into that.
Yeah, send the cavalry from the hill. They've got to protect the flank of the infantry.
Fed up with Persian arrow fire, Nigel finally sends his surviving cavalry into action. And he orders in another unit of reserve cavalry for reinforcement. But a horde of Persian cavalry pile in to meet them.
When we initially looked at their deployment, the archers on their left flank seem well positioned to screen the Macedonian line, but the Macedonian line has moved on and the archers have just been left there on the hillside.
A unit of Persian cavalry spot the exposed archers on the hill and move in for the kill. Fearing for their lives, the archers turn and run in blind panic. But the cavalry make short work of them. Back at the bottom of the hill, the team's horsemen are struggling. The rest of the Persian cavalry finish off the Macedonian archers and join the melee. And suddenly, the team's cavalry are surrounded. The team may have lost the battle for the left flank, but back on the right, their main cavalry assault is going well, and the generals haven't even realized.
It looks like you're being outnumbered with that cavalry being...
Well, I don't know, because the cavalry's been decimated.
No, I don't think they have. Can you wait till we tell you? Because the cavalry actually are charging into the infantry.
Yeah.
OK, and at the moment, they're trying to chew down the line. The whole idea is to kind of go down the line. The cavalry's doing what we sent it there to do.
OK. Here's their cavalry, bogged down in an action with some of the Persian cavalry, some of the Persian infantry. It's not a problem yet. If you look at the ground, you'll see a lot more dead Persians than you'll see dead Macedonians.
But in one corner of the battlefield, Persian troops have isolated and surrounded the team's general, Alexander the Great. One of the greatest generals in history is now dead. But the Macedonians are professionals. They soldier on to maintain the upper hand on this side of the battlefield.
Where are your generals?
I'm dead.
You're dead?
Yeah. It's bizarre. We seem to be doing okay.
Alexander is dead on the field.
Yeah, that's a bit of a hitch if your plan is to do regime change and become the king of kings of Persia, certainly. And his troops are bulldozing around the battlefield, avenging his memory.
But fortunately for us, we have two generals named Richard who will be able to go on and rule the Persian Empire instead.
Can we just send all the pikemen forward?
Yeah,
just keep advancing forward. My guys are going in. Nigel?
Yeah. Send your pikemen forward. My guys are not doing anything at the moment in the middle. Are we going to push them in the middle?
Yeah.
In the middle of the battlefield, the team have waited so long to attack that the Persians are picking off the hoplites with missiles as they slowly advance. The team must get these troops moving quickly to have any chance of this battle going to plan.
They started their cavalry off a long time before they started their infantry off. That's a problem because the infantry are a lot slower than the cavalry. So that means that the cavalry hit unsupported by the infantry. And now, the infantry are going to hit unsupported by the cavalry. And this is what the Macedonians are great at. They're great at grinding away.
We've got the main infantry lines joining combat now in the center of the battlefield.
At last, the team's pike phalanx start to engage. These Macedonian pikemen excel in close combat, but they are vastly outnumbered.
There's a lot more blue than red on this map. Guys, you need to pull together, I think. You're being completely slaughtered now. This doesn't look good, does it? This doesn't look good.
Apparently it doesn't look good, Nigel.
No,
that's
no,
the word from the generals.
I can see that. I can see... Yeah.
Sorry if that comes as a shock.
Not a shock at all.
Well, it's certainly not looking as good as when they formulated their plan, that's for sure.
But keep in mind that a lot of the Persians, look at that large number of Persians legging in.
Some of the rickety Persian conscripts are so terrified by the advancing phalanx that they turn and run. But as the pikemen push forward, slaughtering enemy troops all along the front line, they still face massive numbers of Persians.
Johnny, how do you think we're actually... Have you got any kind of casualty counts here? Because it looks awful on the map, but then again, blocks of their troops keep running off.
Well, there is a Macedonian breakthrough.
That's right, they've broken through. Here we've got some Persians who are trying to get away, and they're failing because they've come up against a Macedonian pike.
The enemy cavalry are routing.
That's good.
John has almost won his fight on the right. He has decimated the Persian heavy cavalry, a troop vital to Persian success. But there are still masses of Persian troops alive and kicking on the left. This is a critical stage in the battle. What the team do next could decide the outcome.
Johnny's side looks good. You've got a lot of red still there, but there's nothing on the left now.
We are engaged on this side. My troops are engaged, OK, mostly. On the other side, though, of the battlefield, we do have a heck of a lot of them.
That's why we need to get them all together and just go like that.
It's interesting the degree to which the two lieutenants, I think, are really in control of the way this is being fought.
The danger of this democratic approach to military command is that while the lieutenants chat about what to do next, their army remains outnumbered. Any delay could give the Persians a chance to regroup.
What's Nigel's plan? You're talking about getting...
I was saying to get all of our troops over on the right and just move.
OK, so you need to come up to us. Join, you come into our battle and then we can sweep down.
Get everyone together in a block? Is that what you want to do? Or?
You want to try and get these troops to pull back here. Because we expect there's going to be a sort of final attack from this side.
The team's in pretty good shape. Because look, here we have the team have got formed unit, formed unit, formed unit, formed unit. If they can consolidate and start doing a bit of good roughy-toughy fix and strike against the Persians over here.
Swing them round, swing them round.
But Nigel's remaining pikemen are so deeply embroiled in combat that they cannot disengage. So John orders his troops on the right to regroup and go to Nigel's aid. It's now a race against time. Nigel needs backup quickly if he's to avoid being wiped out completely.
The team have got to hold their cohesion, they've got to concentrate their remaining combat power, and they've got to give the Persians a really good kicking in hopes that some of the low-grade Persian troops will just leave the field.
You've got two big blocks of troops on the right-hand side. You've got to wheel them around to the left to go and support Nigel.
That's what we're doing.
Hurry
You're going
up.
Right off the,
oh, we're
off
coming!
Right off the
hurry up.
Basically, if we charge, we lose formation. Okay, if we lose formation. So we have to march them.
The friends have been bickering for so long that Nigel is now in dire straits. John's insistence on holding formation means that his hoplites might get there too late.
Nige, okay. I think you're being attacked by archers, so you might want to see whether you can change your formation to disperse the men a bit.
Nigel's wall of steel has taken a good panel beating. But on the right, a unit that John could be sending to Nigel's aid is fully committed to what might be the most critical engagement of the battle.
Johnny, you've got one group, one with a horse in it that's attacking you. That's standing absolutely still doing nothing.
Okay. We can't move them. They are tied up. They are tied up.
Oh, are they?
Fighting a general, and I cannot move them. We've tried.
They're tied up fighting a general?
Yes.
Oh, well, that sounds good.
It's one enemy general who has a weapon against a whole bunch of javelin men without weapons.
It's not just any old general. It's the Persian leader, Darius.
Well, our only hope is basically to get their generals.
And John's troops are only too happy to oblige. The team have killed the Persian King of Kings. Both Darius and Alexander the Great are now dead. But while the professional Macedonians fight on, will the reluctant Persian conscripts stick around to fight without their leader? The team now get on with laying into the remaining Persians on the left.
We're wheeling round to face the rather large forces.
When you go at them, they seem to kind of...
Yeah, they don't like us. They don't like it up them.
John orders his troops to engage the remaining Persian forces. But with King Darius dead, these Persian levies are increasingly unwilling to fight.
They're running away. They're going away from us. They don't want to face us.
Yeah, so I'm saying engage a lot. They're now running past you.
Yeah, but we can't engage them.
They're fleeing.
The Persians are really starting to leave the field in larger numbers.
Yeah, there's a great mob, I suppose. It would be tens of thousands of panic-stricken Persian levies who really want to do nothing other than save their lives at this point and run as fast and as far as they can.
Proportionally, I mean, remember what you were faced with right at the start of the battle, but it's not won, so what are you going to do to secure victory?
Well, it's bizarre. We seem to be doing OK.
And we need to work
Could you tell us where the enemy are? We don't...
And then we need to get ourselves organised rather than just all, like, running around like a school football game.
Well, what...
Nasty, but fair.
No, true. We need to actually reform.
OK. Yeah, I just said that.
Yeah. I just wasn't listening to you, Nigel.
Although the Persian troops are clearly running away, the lifelong friends continue squabbling like schoolchildren. They still can't decide if the enemy are coming or going.
The centre of the map's got little blocks of red, and it's got most of the blocks of blue seem to be moving. Is that cavalry?
Yeah, but which way are they moving? Are they actually moving together?
I think they're fleeing. I don't know how.
I don't think they are. I think they are regrouping.
OK, look, the thing is that we've got heavily, you know, well-trained battle-experienced troops.
Are they fleeing or regrouping?
They're regrouping.
Do you know?
We need to form a cohesive unit that if they regroup...
Yeah, we said that 5 minutes ago and they didn't do anything about it.
Well, we've been trying, haven't we?
I know, yes, I know.
A victory imminent.
How on earth
A victory is imminent. Excellent.
Well, it's down to the generals, I think.
You are victorious. Hooray, we did it. Excellent. You are victorious. I'll give up surgery and become a soldier, I think.
All right, John, Nigel.
Congratulations, Mr. General.
Against overwhelming odds, the team have pulled off a famous victory by clever use of their cavalry and phalanx units.
Obviously, those tactics.
Congratulations.
Thank you very much.
It was the well-thought battle plan. Yeah.
But does this surprising win owe more to luck than judgment?
I got a sense there that maybe the victory took you by surprise.
I think we forgot that they had mercenaries who obviously have no emotional stake in the battle. If the battle is going to be lost, they're going to be out of there. We also forgot that our troops, probably greatest strength is their battle-hardened. They're very, very experienced.
Yeah. John, why the maniacal laughter when victory was announced?
I felt that they were withdrawing in order just to basically regroup and then swamp us.
You were just wrong.
I was?
All right, well, look, let's get the official verdict on how you did. Mark and Alec have been watching everything you've been doing.
Classic style.
Or is any winner win?
Something is a Pyrrhic victory, perhaps.
Alec, what do you think?
I was really gobsmacked by how well these guys did.
You met them beforehand, then?
Well, no, they were given the task of trying to replicate one of the great achievements of Alexander the Great. They were put onto a field against a much larger army, and they were put into a battle which Alexander won by being a military genius. And it was, to some extent, an unfair task. I would have expected them to win with brute force, but no, they actually won with subtlety and cleverness and a lot of brute force. So I'm really impressed by these guys. How did you guys mean to use your cavalry and your infantry together?
Bluff it.
Cavalry to blitzkrieg. Infantry to hold the line.
So you were going to fix them with the infantry and strike them with the cavalry?
Yeah, strike with the cavalry first, then follow that up with the infantry straight after.
So you were seeking synergy between your cavalry and infantry. Now, had you achieved simultaneity, then you too would be Alexander the Great. You would be a military genius. But the fact that you tried to do that bought you a really good battlefield result. And the fact that you screened your flanks as well as you did, you had cavalry and archers looking after your left, you had cavalry and light infantry looking after your right, meant that you were able to achieve the battlefield result you wanted. Really well done, guys.
Thank you.
Thank you.
There's one small bitter aftertaste to all this, though. By being Alexander only more so, you've led from the front. He's dead.
Which
is a bit of a setback if you want to be King of Kings and enjoy all the orgies that come with that job title. But overall, you did very well.
Tell me how it really happened.
OK, this is the real Macedonian deployment.
Wait. I have so many people. I am so powerful. I am the King of Kings. Now I need a stick.
OK, you've got the Macedonian deployment here. You've got the phalanx, the great pike phalanx, as the great line of infantry. You've got the cavalry secured by flanks, only because Alexander the Great isn't quite as hard as you guys, he's got his hoplites as a second line, ready to meet unexpected contingencies on the flanks as he advances. But of course, being Alexander the Great and being in command of the great phalanx, he's going to advance, and that's what he does. He sets off his main line of troops, and as they go forward, there's a tendency for them to move towards the right, the Macedonian right and the Persian left. As the Macedonian phalanx makes its way forward, I think I'm going to nip round to this part of the table.
Feel free to move. You've got control of the room.
They didn't know what they were doing.
as they continue moving forward and still pulling off to the right here to concentrate their force on just a part of the Persian line, they do what's called refusing a flank. Alexander doesn't want to get this flank attacked by the Persian cavalry, so he brings back some phalanxes and bends the line and puts these men under his trusted lieutenant Parmenio.
Bessus, who is Darius's commander out here on the left, sends a whole lot of cavalry out here to mix it in with Alexander's cavalry. And there's a whole cavalry battle that develops here on the left.
But Alexander himself and the key squadrons of the companion cavalry staying close to him remain unengaged with the vulgar horde. The phalanx keeps coming forward and at a last moment accelerates into the Persian line, and as they go, the companion cavalry is ready to take each of these Persian units in the flank as it's pinned at the front by the Macedonians, and they're absolutely... Oh, no, absolutely. It's pretty much exactly what you were doing, except what they succeeded in doing was disengaging each time rather than pursuing and getting stuck in on the next one, clear that one, next one, and they started basically rolling up the Persian line, but the Persians still had one more move left in them.
The Persians on the left send people off to try to deal with Alexander's cavalry, but they see that fight over there. They assume that's where they need to be. So the extra cavalry on that side go charging off into the distance. They're never seen again. And off here on the right, Darius's cavalry and some of Darius's light troops, they see an irresistible thing opening. They see that big hole there. And they start driving through that big hole. Cavalry drive through the big hole. The cavalry see Alexander's camp way in the back, 5-7 miles away. And they go shooting off there to try to rescue Darius's mom and Darius's wife and kids, who are all being held hostage by Alexander. They charge off. Maybe they come back. Maybe they don't. They're out of the fight. And the rest of Darius's army starts getting in here, except for one guy, Darius. Darius sees everything starting to go wrong, and Darius turns around and leaves the field. The King of Kings is going to live to fight another day. But meanwhile, look at all those guys over there.
Right, okay. The hoplites nip off any further exploitation of that gap, and Alexander himself comes around, joins in the final climactic melee and the slaughter of those few Persian troops who've managed to get into that gap in the Macedonian lines. And the battle is concluded. Alexander gets his regime changed. The whole Persian Empire simply fits in, obeys his commands. He's in charge. Inordinate amounts of heavy drinking, celebratory orgy. No biped with a pulse is safe.
At the real Battle of Gaugamela, Alexander the Great's army won a decisive victory. The Persian Emperor Darius fled the battlefield, only to be hunted down and murdered by one of his own commanders. Alexander was crowned king of all Asia and went on to control over half the known world, an empire stretching from Greece to India.
All right. Thank you very much indeed.
Thank you.
You enjoy yourselves?
Yeah, absolutely. Especially the winning bits.
We were hoping you'd lose and there'd be tears, but that's television.
Hey,
so thank you very much.
Thank you.
Well done, Richard. Hard work.
Test your knowledge of Alexander the Great's Sky Digital Viewers, press red. It's Attila the Hun versus the Romans tonight at 8 o'clock. Coming up next on UK TV History, People's Century recalls student unrest and worldwide demonstrations in 1968.